Sitting at your desk looking at your monitor during the day, there's really nothing out of the ordinary. But if the sun sets, or I just cut the lights, and the room darkens, you get this characteristic glow from the monitor, contributing to that feeling of an overwhelmingly bright light in the darkness. This is called a bloom effect, and at its heart, it can be both a simple and surprisingly complex effect to implement. Do it right, and it looks subtle and sells that idea of an overwhelmingly bright light. But do it wrong, and the scene ends up looking a bit wonky, kind of straight out of the mid-2000s. Let's talk about how it used to be done, way back in the day. There's really no official correct way to do this, whatever works, but the premise basically works like this. You've got a copy of your main frame buffer, and you'll apply some basic operations. You threshold the image, meaning you choose the bright parts to bloom out. You downsample it, mostly for performance reasons. And you apply a bunch of blur to it. That's how you get that bleed-over effect. Once you've done all that, they can be combined in some hand-wavy way that looks nice to end up with a bloomed-out image. That's the theory anyway. It's not really set in stone. This is kind of an artistic effect, so in reality, you're going to just go with whatever works and looks nice. Let's talk about thresholding an image first. So what most people do is take the image and do some sort of luminance cutoff. The reasoning behind this was simple. A lot of stuff only ran with 8 bits per channel. Nowadays, modern hardware is fast enough to support floating point buffers wherever you need them, but back in the dark ages, you often went with 8-bit channels. Xbox 360 had a 10-bit float format, but I don't think the PS3 had an equivalent. So yeah, you take your image, and there's a bunch of ways people did this. You could contrast the heck out of your image, basically preserving the bright areas and dropping off the rest. You can also set a luminance threshold, so calculate luminance per pixel, and then drop off towards zero everything below a certain threshold. The general idea is that you need to isolate some part of the image for blooming, not all of it, because we're going to be additively blending this bad boy back onto the screen later. And without dropping off some parts, it'll look like a bit of a disaster. You can use the full-size main color target directly, but working with a smaller version of that is faster and cheaper. So it's normal to take your main color target and downsample that to a fraction of the size. Every time you have your resolution, the number of pixels processed gets cut by 75%, which is pretty insane savings. The trade-off here is that, as you progressively downsample, you risk shimmering artifacts due to the lack of resolution. Then there's a blur pass, so you'll take your main color, which has probably been downsampled, and then you'll blur it somehow. Now, a dead simple way is good old box blur. Nothing beats that. The basic idea is to convolve the image with an equal weight kernel that might look something like this. And that basically amounts to, if you were to zoom in and look at individual pixels, for any given pixel in the input image, you'd sample the nearby pixels and then average them all together to produce the final pixel in the output image. Go and do that a few zillion times for every pixel in the image, and you'll get a slightly blurry image. This has some obvious limitations. For starters, to get a bigger radius, you can either skip pixels, which just kind of looks bad. You can see the artifacts there pretty clearly. Or you can expand the kernel, which looks better, but comes at the steep cost of being n squared for the radius you want to blur. Bad options all around. Luckily, the box filter is what's referred to as a separable filter in image processing, meaning that the 2D version can be expressed as two one-dimensional filters. That is, it can be done along the horizontal axis, or the x-axis, and then the output of that can be run through another filter on the vertical, or y-axis. So I can start with the source image, and we can start by applying a box filter along the x-axis. Notice the blurring in the image is strictly horizontal. Once we've finished doing that, we can apply a second box filter along the y-axis, giving us the box filter in 2n steps, rather than n squared. An arguably higher quality blur is to do a Gaussian, which is just changing the weights around in the kernel. Instead of equal weights, you can bias the weight towards the center pixel. The kernel basically looks like this, kind of a hill with a raised center and a gentle falloff towards the sides. Contrast that to a box filter, which is exactly what it says. It's a box. This is separable, just like the box blur, so it's easy to get going. There's other kernels here too, but I feel like the important takeaway here is the general idea that you want to make a blurry version of the scene. Now that you've got your blurred out copy of the scene, you blend it back over the screen as a post effect, generally an additive pass. And that's it. That's all it is. Problem is, doing it this way is part of the reason why the games in the mid-2000s looked so bloom heavy. They relied on using things like thresholds to bloom out. If you've got an 8-bit per channel buffer, that means that the maximum value is 255. If you choose to, say, use luminance to threshold what's bright and what isn't, i.e. what blooms and what doesn't, that approach makes zero distinction between just a white object and a glowing hot one. The end result being, it's super hard to get under control. Back in the day, we developers thought it looked awesome and so next gen. And it kinda did, so how about shut up? But let's look at how they've improved the approach in some of the major engines since those bright, bloomy days. So in general, any current generation implementation of Bloom is going to be trying to accomplish a few things. It's going to be high quality, nuanced. We're long past the days where Bloom is new and exciting, so Bloom implementations want to give that feeling of an overwhelmingly bright light without beating us over the head with it. Performant. This should be obvious, but it should be fast. Real fast. Kawase's blur filter. Let's talk about new approaches. But before that, way back at GDC 2003, this was before I even started in the industry, there was a presentation by Misaki Kawase, I don't know. It was a very clever way to use GPU hardware to get a really nice blur for cheap. The idea is, take the main image, take four bilinear samples, and use those to downsample progressively to a smaller resolution. In the talks, I think they mentioned a quarter resolution. After that, you'll ping-pong between two textures, each time taking four samples at a time with an increasing offset. By iterating this over and over again, you can get a really good approximation to a large Gaussian blur for really few texture samples. This is important because this algorithm serves as the backbone for pretty much all the modern approaches. Let's start by taking a look at Unity's Bloom implementation. In 2014, the folks at Sledgehammer Games, they were the ones behind the latest, at the time, iteration of Call of Duty. So they outlined how their Bloom implementation worked. Their technique was an evolution of the Kawase filter that we just outlined. The idea is as follows. You take your frame buffer, and there's no threshold step. With HDR commonplace now, this isn't needed. And you downsample it to create basically a MIP chain. The default way is to take a bilinear sample right in the middle of every four texels, and the Kawase method showed us that you could take four taps instead of one. They decided, screw it, we're taking 13 taps. And it's really neat what they do here. So if you're looking at this group of pixels, and we're going to take 9 samples total, the upper left four will form a group, the upper right will form another, and so on. Lastly, there'll be one group of four samples in the middle, and that puts a large bias towards those center pixels. The idea being that this should help reduce pulsing artifacts. These are all combined with a single equation, with half the weight being the center four, and the rest of the four groups getting equal weight. One extra trick they added here is that on the very first downsample, they take the Keras average based on luminance, which helps preserve bright pixels. Next, they progressively upsample, starting with the smallest downsampled image. Each step, they apply a tent filter to the downsampled version and also sum in the previous MIP. I think this is based on the slides. So once you do that for a while, you'll end up with a fully downsampled and then re-upsampled image, which you then lerp with the main image to get a bloomed out scene. And overall, it looks pretty good. Notice that the scene isn't too bloomed out like in shots from earlier in the video. The bloom is more subtle and comes off more as a glow rather than a weird haze. So Unreal's approach seems to be mostly an extension on those same older techniques. They go over the general approach way back in their SIGGRAPH 2012 presentation on the technology behind the Unreal Engine 4 Elemental demo. From what I can gather, they take the main image, the frame buffer, and from that they progressively downsample a fixed number of times using a plain Kawase blur. Then they do a similar upscaling process as Unity, but from the sounds of it, they do a small separable Gaussian blur at each level, which is artist configurable, so you can modify the size of the blur at each level to your taste. They also add some knobs and dials for doing things like applying tints to each level, giving you that extra level of artistic control. So I could, for example, specifically choose to tint an individual layer of the bloom chain while leaving the rest as varying shades of gray, or something to that effect. I haven't tried profiling it. My guess is that it's slightly more expensive than Unity's approach, but can give higher quality and more flexible results. This is based on no actual research on my part. So while most of these approaches are just tweaks and evolutions on Kawase's approach from way back, the newer versions of Unreal Engine come with a fancy new convolution bloom, which is really interesting. If you have a signal, let's represent it with a seemingly random function here, then you can use something called the Fourier transform to decompose that function into a series of sinusoids, a series of sine and cosines of varying amplitudes and frequencies. If you take an image and imagine each pixel as data points of a 2D signal, of a two-dimensional function, then we can use a 2D transform to convert this to frequency space, and then we can use the inverse Fourier transform to bring this back to our original image. The whole theory and background behind the Fourier transform deserves a long video by itself, which I clearly didn't do. There are some phenomenal resources on YouTube, which I've got linked in the description. For our purposes, I think it's probably sufficient to know that this transformation exists and what it buys you in terms of functionality. Once you've converted this to the frequency domain, there's some really cool manipulations you can do. A high-pass filter is one that preserves high-frequency information while removing low-frequency information. And that's as simple as multiplying by zeroing out the image near the origin before doing the inverse FFT. A low-pass filter is the exact opposite, preserving low-frequency information while discarding high, which is the inverse of what we just did, and that gives us a really blurry image. In fact, I can actually perform a Gaussian blur in a similar way by using the Fourier transform of a Gaussian filter, which lets me perform a Gaussian blur for pretty much free. I mean, free after the FFT, which wasn't even slightly free. That kind of leads us to an interesting property of the frequency domain. Multiplying two images together in the frequency domain is the equivalent to convolving them in the time domain. This is where Unreal's new convolution bloom is so neat and different. You can create custom bloom kernel images. So here, for example, I can create a star-like image, which I've done just by drawing some 2D SDFs. I've also added a bit of Gaussian blurs on top of that. Now we can transform that kernel that I just made into frequency space via the FFT and multiply our Fourier transformed image. Then, when we take the inverse of that using the inverse FFT, that ends up being our blurry bloom buffer. When we combine that with the frame buffer, it gives us this neat streaking effect that would be a lot more difficult to do with conventional methods, but trivial using this approach. The unfortunate downside is that doing an FFT is a heavy operation, but I imagine it's one that we'll probably see more often as graphics hardware undoubtedly gets more and more powerful. There was a time when doing simple loops was unfathomable, so a few more iterations on hardware and this will be a small blip on the profiler. Until next time, cheers.